You're listening to the Deep Purple Podcast, a fan podcast about one of the most legendary bands of all time, Deep Purple. We take a look at the music, history, and people behind the band Deep Purple and beyond.
Welcome to the Deep Purple Podcast, the first and only podcast devoted to one of the greatest bands in rock history, Deep Purple. Today's episode is episode number 101, Deep Purple, Perfect Strangers, Part 2. And coming to you from the fully vaccinated suburbs of Chicago, I'm your host, Nathan Parfait en Canoe Beaudry.
And coming to you from the suburbs of Providence, I'm your co-host, John Bartakumus Matola.
So I think we've pretty much just accepted that you are Balky and I'm Larry. I think there was some confusion about it last week, but we've settled into our roles.
Well, I for one know there's somebody out there that's really pissed that I got stuck with Balky.
Someone's upset that you got stuck with Balky?
Yes.
Who's that?
Rich.
Why is he upset that you're Balky?
I don't know. He's he texted me earlier and he's just like, first Nate gets all the records and now you get stuck with Balky.
Well, you're probably more temperament wise, more of a Larry, but
you think so? You know what? I haven't seen the show in a while. Like, I was thinking about it earlier. I'm like, by now I probably should have looked up a couple of episodes on YouTube because I don't even remember like any of like the dynamic of the show or anything. But I mean, I'm just guessing that I would be like a goofball like Balky, but maybe I'm not.
I think it's, yeah, well, I mean, he was partially a goofball, partially. It was an interesting thing because back in the 80s, it was like perfectly acceptable to be like, ha ha, that guy's foreign and he doesn't know things about this country, ha ha. But the interesting thing about that is they made up a nationality. So it wasn't even like, you can't look back at it and be like, oh, it's so inappropriate how they treated the people of Meepos. It's not even a real place, so you can kind of,
yeah, but you
almost get away with it.
Maybe almost, but I feel like somebody could dig in and just be like, well, and look at that, it's acceptable to just laugh at somebody and make them a brunt of a joke with somebody from another country. Like, it, yeah, doesn't even have to be real. Like, you just look at it, like, any, that could be any foreigner, you know, and it's like in the United States, how dare they.
Yeah, but I feel like there's not as much ground to stand on. But yeah, you're right. But that was the, yeah, that was the major energy in the 80s was just like, ha ha, that person has an accent or can't speak English 100% or whatever. And that was just kind of like the punchline for a lot of stuff. And when you look back at it now, it's like, you know, all the obviously kind of inappropriate stuff aside, you're also just like, that's kind of lazy, just like making fun of somebody, because, you know, you could just as easily take an American and throw them in, you know, spin a wheel any country in the world and they're gonna, you know, fall on their face too, as anyone would if they don't know the language. But hey, we're not here to talk about all these crazy social issues. We don't want to generate any hatred or violence towards the people of Meepos. They're peace loving wonderful people. We're here to talk about Deep Purple and Perfect Strangers, the Deep Purple version. Before we get into it, so last week, if you haven't listened to last week's episode, you probably should start there. It's part one. We cover the whole history of going into the album, the reformation, and then the first side of the album, and we're going to kind of pick it up when we get through our opening here. We're going to pick up on side two and spin those songs and close with some reviews and things like that. But before we do that, we just want to talk about some ways you can support the show. First of all, you could leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. And hey, you know what? We do have one coming in this week. This is an old one. This one's we're picking Canada as the country this year. There were no reviews from Meepos. So we're going to the next best thing, which is Canada. this week's review, 5 stars from Kobaya2112. Must be a Rush fan. This was from 2019, June of 2019. So it's an old one. The title, A Great Purple Cast. Always cool to hear other fans talking about a band you like. Great podcast with some good research and cool info. Don't miss it if you're a fan of Deep Purple and its extended family. So thank you, Kobaya. Hopefully you're listening. It's like been almost 2 years since this review was written. I'm just like secretly thinking like all these people are just really offended. Everyone from every other country is just like, those jerks never read my review and stopped listening in anger. We lost all these great listeners, but hopefully you're still listening, Kobaya.
Well, maybe they'll come back.
Yeah, and you know, maybe if we read your review late like this, let us know. We're trying to get caught up on all of those reviews. So one way to support the show is write us a 5-star review, no matter what country you're from. If you're not from America, we're going to have to kind of type in country codes and stumble upon it. But if you write one, shoot us an email and tell us you wrote one, because we would need to know exactly what country you're from to be able to find it because of the silly way that Apple does this. You can also buy merch at our Etsy store. I wonder what
the country code for Meepos would be.
M-P? M-Y? I don't even know how to spell Meepos. Why don't you look that up while I go through the rest of this? So merch on our Etsy store. Just sold a couple more t-shirts today, actually. So we're still moving shirts, and we've got mugs left as well. So check it out. And then lastly, you could become a patron on Patreon or donate on PayPal for as little as $1 a month. You can help support the show. If you receive any sort of value from what we do, from listening to the podcast, from following the social media feeds, all that sort of stuff, and you just want to help support us and make sure that we continue to be around, then just drop us as little as $1. We'd really appreciate it. And speaking of patrons, hey-o! We've got a new patron this week. This is the legendary, coming in at the $5 moneylender tier, the legendary Kev Roberts, who we've been communicating with for forever, it seems like. Mostly on Twitter, Kev is. Kev says, congrats on the 100 shows. In honor of this landmark, I finally dipped my hand into my pocket and subscribed, which I've been meaning to do for ages. Loved the SBTE episode, Straight Between the Eyes. Other highlights for me are Rising episode and Who Do We Think We Are. Look forward to many more. So thank you very much, Kev. We really appreciate it.
Yes.
And I like that, you know, finally dipped into my pockets thing, because I know for me, sometimes like it's not the money. It's just like, you're driving when you hear it, and you're, when I stop, I'm gonna do that. And then you forget, you get caught up. So we really appreciate not only the money, but the fact that you took the time to do it. So thank you so much to everybody who does that. And then we divide up our patrons. So in this first segment here, we thank our executive level patrons at the $20 Shades of Deep Pockets tier. We have Ryan M. The $15 Highball Shooter tier, we have Alan, Ain't Too Proud to Beg. At the Turn It Up to $11 tier, we have Frank Thielgard Mortensen, Clay Wambacher, and Mikkel Steen. And at the $10 Someone Came tier, Steve Seaborg of NameOnAnything.com and AllTheWorldsAstage.net, Jeff Bryce, Gerald Kelly, and Victor Campos. Thank you so much to all of you for all of your support of the show. All right, John, what details do you have on Meepos?
All right, so Belki Bartakamus is a fictional character. It's from Wikipedia. Mm-hmm. Played by Bronson Pinchot.
Yep.
In the TV sitcom Perfect Strangers. He is from the fictional island of Meepos, M-Y-P-O-S, which is near Greece and based on Greek culture.
Yeah, but then you see it in the show, and he's herding sheep and things.
I don't know. I mean, Meepo sounds like it could be from Greece.
Yeah, it definitely sounds.
Maybe
Greek.
It was like loosely based. Maybe it's. Yeah, I didn't think of it until it said that. But
I always thought it was spelled MYPO.
Yeah, he said. Yeah, that's what it sounds like. After returning from a trip to Greece, he decided to base the character in the fictional island of Meepos on the people he encountered in the villages of Greece.
All right.
So there you go. And Pinchot came up with the name Belki after his sister's dog that she named Balcony and ended up calling him Belki for short.
Balcony?
Yeah, that's weird on its own. Like, who names their dog Balcony? Like you know, a thing that you go out and stand on. Thing.
Yeah, like Don't Cry For Me, Argentina.
Yeah, that's how it was spelled.
That's weird.
Yeah. You know, a thing that, what's his face, stood on. Mussolini. Mussolini. You know, old what's his face?
What's his face? Oh, good old Mussolini.
You know who's it? You know, old who's it? You know.
Oh man, good stuff. Before we go on, I do have to, I did mention a beer last week, and I have to mention another beer this week. This one, as I open it up, is not quite, there's a story behind it. This is a beer that's called Budweiser. And, the reason that I'm opening
do
that
tell,
up,
do tell.
So on, last, Sunday, I got my second dose of the COVID shot. And then as soon as I got it, people started contacting me from out of the woodwork being like, oh, get ready. It's going to be a nightmare. And I was like, oh no. So I spent like 8 hours just being like, am I going to get really sick? And then, yep, I got really, really sick. And we canceled recording last week because, I was just in bed, like comical, cartoon, like covers up like this, teeth chattering, just freezing, like chills. Super high fever, everything you can imagine, just absolutely horrible experience. And then all of a sudden, boop, felt better. But the day that was March 8th. And March 8th is my cousin Robbie's birthday, who passed away. Oh God, how long ago has it been now? 12, 13 years now ago that he passed away. And used to go visit him. They had a place in New Hampshire and another place in Maryland. And he's a great guy, and he loved Budweiser, and Budweiser was his, not when we were kids hanging out, but when he got older, he loved Budweiser. So every year on his birthday, I have a beer, a Budweiser, in his honor. And it's the only time I drink Budweiser. And I was not gonna, this is the first year in a long time that I didn't do it, because I was just in bed dying all day. Just shivering and chills. And
good reason.
Yeah, I was like, maybe I could just open a Budweiser and take one sip. I was like, no, I'm not even going to go there. So I figured maybe it would be even better to commemorate him on the show. He was very instrumental in getting me into kind of hard rock and metal. One of the times I went to visit him in New Hampshire, he had just gotten the Fat Boys tape. And I remember him playing that, and like, I got this new tape, and we just listened to this tape. The whole whatever, I don't know how long we were there, maybe like a long weekend or something. We'd just be like, he was like right by a lake. So we go out and we were fishing for crawdads in the lake and cooking them up and listening to the Fat Boys and just having the best time. And then a few years later, I went to go visit him. I think it was in Maryland that time. And I remember going up to his bedroom, and he was just like, oh yeah, I got this new tape, Metallica. And I'd never heard of Metallica. And this was right after Master of Puppets had come out. I don't think Injustice for All was out yet. And he played it for me, and just being like blown away, just like, what is this crazy, like evil, but like kind of like menacing. Like I just remember feeling like, it's like, am I supposed to be listening to this? Am I going to get in trouble for listening to this? Even though there's nothing really like crazy on that album or anything. And that kind of really set me down a course of like getting into Metallica, and then later on their, you know, the Injustice for All album and Megadeth and all that sort of stuff. So, you know, we talk a lot about that sort of stuff on the show. So I thought it was worth bringing up and thanking him for, I don't know when my entry point to Metallica would have been if it hadn't been for that, but you know, he was 2-3 years older than me. So, so he kind of was ahead of the curve. So to my cousin Robbie, I take this drink of Budweiser. And you know what? I don't mind Budweiser. Bud Light, I can do without, but Budweiser's not bad. Anyway, that's my cousin Robbie.
Yeah, I don't very much see anybody with a regular Budweiser.
No, it doesn't really happen that much. I don't know what the sales are like, but yeah. And I wonder if Robbie was, we never talked to Deep Purple. I wonder if what his awareness was of Deep Purple or, but unfortunately, he passed away way too young, so. Okay. Well, with that memory behind us and still at the front of mind, we're into side two here. Should we, and it feels so weird to be getting into the songs right away like this, but that's kind of how we split up the episode. So are you physically and mentally prepared to dive right into side two here?
All right, wait a minute.
he's stretching his guns. If you're listening to the audio podcast, you can't see this, but he's wearing a tank top, showing off the tats.
I don't know why I'm wearing a tank top. It's friggin' freezing out.
What are you doing? I mean, it was snowing all day here today.
I don't know. Well, yeah, it got sharply very cold here, but I'm like, lately I've been, and I mean, I don't sleep with like a ton of blankets on, or I keep it like, you know, abnormally warm in here, but I mean, I've been waking up in the middle of the night, like really, really hot. Mm-hmm. And just like just ripping off like my shirt or whatever. And it's, so I'm like, okay, so it's either a tank top or no shirt, but it's like, I'll go to bed feeling snuggly and being like, all right, I'll have on like a t-shirt or maybe even a hoodie or something, you know, because you get all nice and cozy, especially a couple of nights ago, there was like, you know, really big gusts of wind. So you're laying in bed and you hear that big, like outside, and you're just like all covers up to here. You're like, yeah, this is it. And then you wake up at like, I wake up at like 3 a.m. like, ugh, you know, sweating like I'm in an interrogation room. Like, oh God. So no, like, but either that or I'm just freaking old. So
well, it's a combination of the two. But when I was the other night, when I was super, so the symptoms started kicking in right before bed, and I was, so I didn't sleep all night. It was just a terrible night. And eventually the kids wanted, like one or two kids decided to come in bed, and I was like, I'm just going down to the guest room because I need to just be miserable in bed by myself. And I went, and I was so cold, and my wife had, I was downstairs in the guest room bed, and there was like a little drying rack that my wife was drying some stuff she had washed, and one of my son's winter hats was on there because he had left it out in the snow, like who knows when, and the snow started to melt, so she had washed it a bunch of times, and it was dry, and I was so cold I just reached over and grabbed it and just jammed it down onto my head just for extra warmth. I, that's how cold I was. I wanted to wear a winter hat while I was sleeping. Wow. I don't know if I've ever had that sensation before. But yeah.
Well, not, glad that that's over.
Probably not a great advertisement for dose two of the vaccine, but that's how I dealt with it anyway. Hopefully,
I hear that that's
very.
Yeah.
Did you get dose one yet?
Yeah, hopefully. No. I'm not looking forward to either one of them.
Well, if,
I mean, I don't mind waiting in line. I don't mind getting a shot. I do mind feeling like shit.
Yeah, round one wasn't bad for me. I just felt like really tired the next day and just wanted to not be at work. And I wishing I hadn't scheduled myself to work late the following day. I was like, this was really stupid.
Yeah.
But it was totally doable. Round two, not doable. I was just miserable. But as quickly as it came on, it's like somebody flipped the light switch, bink, and then all of a sudden I was just felt instantly 10 times better, but very wrung out. So I guess it's it's good in that respect. It's like getting a bad flu, except with a bad flu, you don't know when it's going to end. With this one, you know, you're going to feel really lousy for 24 hours, and then you're going to feel just kind of regular lousy for maybe 48. So
yeah,
you can rest easy knowing that, I guess. But hey, we're not here to tell you too much about the COVID vaccine. Hopefully you're getting yours and getting over it if you have gotten yours and feeling better. So with that, without further ado, we're going to go into side two, the album and the title track, the titular Perfect Strangers. Probably one of the most iconic openings of any Deep Purple song, and unlike a lot of Deep Purple songs, it doesn't start with the build up like one instrument coming in after another. This just all hits you right in the face.
I mean, you got to admit, John Lord hasn't had too many moments, so to speak, on this album, but he's gotten like two really impressive intros.
Yeah,
this being one of them.
Those little notes that Richie's picking. He's picking those little individual notes out of the chord.
Yeah,
makes me think of the video. It's like all these different like superimposed shots of me and Gillan freaking out during that part. Guitar run he does going right into the chorus there. I love that little patch he's using there. It sounds like a chorus of voices almost.
Mm-hmm. One motif I've seen running through this album is they have some kind of darkish kind of passages.
And that part, I remember so distinctly that part that where it goes into, I guess it's like 9-4, or it's like 1-bar 4-4, 1-bar 5-4, alternating.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the first time I ever heard this was on Nobody's Perfect when they did it live. And I just remember thinking that was sounded so heavy. Like that kind of like, that sounded more to heavy metal, like heavy metal to me than most Deep Purple stuff did.
Well, as you think about like a lot of what makes a heavy metal song isn't just the fast riffs or the distorted guitars or whatever, is a lot of it can just be you know, the key that a song is in, the melody, the notes that they play. Like this, you know, this can be heavy and not be like,
yeah,
quote unquote metal.
And just the dark nature,
like,
of
I think,
it too.
Yeah. Like, this is heavy.
I think this is the heaviest thing, maybe outside of Ted the Mechanic, that Deep Purple ever did. Oh, maybe Bloodsucker. I don't know. I don't know what that
patch
is.
But I mean, it's also in that.
It's like a strings patch on his keys.
Yeah, it's good stuff. But I mean, I always think that I like this too, because it's kind of the same chord structure as Heaven on Their Minds from Jesus Christ Superstar.
Oh, good call.
Which I always thought was another one, right? Like 1970, like super heavy riff.
Oh, super heavy. Not what you'd expect from a musical either.
No.
And so here we are with us, apart from those few little like licks leading into the chorus from Ritchie and the little noodling by John. Ooh, he's doing a little bit, but there's no real solo at all in that song.
No, and that's kind of a nice way to kind of fade out of the song, is just this kind of like haunting little, I don't know, what would you say it sounded like? Like a kind of a flute type.
Yeah, like a flute patch. He's got those like ha ha ha, those like vocal sounding, almost maybe like a mellotron. I don't think it is a mellotron, but it sounds almost like that. And then yeah, he's got like a little flute patch or something you might hear like Colin Towns play on a Gillan band song. But yeah, it's a very kind of haunting song, and opens with that just ripping classic John Lord organ sound, which is just phenomenal.
Yeah, I think haunting is a really appropriate word for this song, which you don't really think of haunting when you think of Deep Purple.
No, not normally. Even though we covered their song Haunted a few episodes ago. But that's not a very haunting song.
But it was not haunting.
No, it was haunted, not haunting. Yeah, Roger Glover says this was one of the best tracks he'd ever been involved with, either in writing, producing, or playing, and it was his favorite track on the album. So, I mean, I would be willing to bet this is the most people's favorite track on the album. It was released as a single with the B-side of Son of Alaric, which would later be released as a bonus track in later releases. So, all right, what do you think about Perfect Strangers?
I think that the worksheet isn't letting me do anything. Uh-oh. I know that I'm in the right one.
Have you been locked out?
There we go.
There you go.
Nope. Perfect Strangers, 5.
Oh, hey-o.
Yeah, hey-o, 5. Now, a 5 is, as we know, I was thinking about it, and I was trying, I think on our, maybe it was our episode with Chris Allen, I was trying to explain, like, what a 5 is to me, because I was getting a lot of, like, whoa, look at the cojones on him giving it a 5 type
Chris,
of
Chris was really impressed
type of vibe.
Which one was it? Power, when you give Power a 5, he
power,
was
yeah.
he was jealous, and I was like, you know, you could also give it a 5. he was like, man, I wish I was as but cool as John. like you just that was funny.
But see, this is like, but I thought about it later, and I don't think I was able to put it into words, but a 5 is a song that I rate that I really like and I think is good, but it's a song that I will always play. Mm-hmm. Like it's like if I was like, if I had an album, like if I had an album that had like 2 or 3 5s on it, if I didn't want to hear the whole album, those are the only songs that I would ever skip to and want to hear like every time. Mm-hmm. So that's what a 5 means to me is like, I mean, is it, I mean, yeah, it's, I mean, obviously it's gotta be the best song for me. It's the song that I don't ever not want to hear it. Like I always want to hear it. I skip right to it on the album. It's like the one that I don't typically get tired of, whether that's the popular opinion or not. I mean, in this case, I would think that most people,
yeah,
most Purple fans would say, sure. And I like it because obviously it's classic. You have a classic intro. But I mean, it's also just really the word haunting is probably the best word that we, you know, could use to describe it in one word. Plus, I mean, you know, Gillan has done a lot of great vocals over the years, but this is the first one I think in a while where he's like really made use of the technology, doing backing vocals, like putting echo on his vocals, like you know, them kind of swirling all over the place, like you know, after the end of the first verse, and just kind of all coming together, and it's just like, you know, Ritchie with the guitar in the back, you know, the rhythm section just holding it down, you know, with just that kind of like steady kind of beat. Yeah, I mean, what else is there to say? I mean, it's classic for a reason.
Yeah. Well, Perfect Strangers also gets a perfect 5 from me as well. And like you said, for me, a 5 is not just a great song, but a song that I like think about all the time, and that's always kind of top of mind, or after I definitely a song I would never skip. A song, you know, when they played this when I went to see them live, it was just like, yeah, like I was more excited about this song than I honestly thought I would be. And I've always loved this song, but it just kind of it actually surprised me a little bit, like way more excited about this than hearing Smoke on the Water or Hush or just you know, nothing against those songs, but this one for some reason just really jumped out. The same thing with Knocking at Your Back Door. It's one of those things, like the lyrics are always spinning around in my head, the melody's always spinning around in my head, and this is like obviously one of, if you had to have people rank their favorite Deep Purple songs, this would be in the top five for a lot of fans. But it's not really typical of them. It's got the weird time change segment, which they generally don't do. It's got no solos. Very understated. Nobody shows off. Ian Gillan puts in a great vocal performance, but there's no screams or anything over the top. It's a very strong vocal performance. Ritchie throws in some really cool little licks, like I said, going to the chorus. John Lord's doing his thing. Everyone's playing is impeccable, but it's just a really great piece of songwriting and something that's always, the second I heard that, I'll remember it like it was yesterday, hearing that playing da-da-dun, as soon as I heard that, I just thought, wow, this is like Deep Purple's, they're heavy metal. And I wouldn't call them heavy metal now, but some people loop them into that. But yeah, just a great, great song. And like I think I talked about in the last episode, Knocking at Your Back Door starts so strong. You think, how can they top this going into the second side? But then you see, well, the first song on the second side is named after the album. So it's probably pretty good. And they do not disappoint.
Mm.
So awesome, awesome track. All right. Next up, we have the second track on the second side, and that's A Gypsy's Kiss. It wouldn't be a Deep Purple song if it didn't have the word gypsy in the album title, on the album somewhere. Really, I don't know if he's got a delay on his bass, if that's what his... Or if he's just picking really fast. That part is always reminding me of something. Maybe it just reminds me of the song, I don't know. I love when Gillan looks at this.
I love that. I love that riff. It's just really catchy. I feel like the we're not talking a lot. We're just like listening.
Very bizarre lyrics.
I love how the main riff belongs to John Lord.
Yeah, and Roger Glover's like doubling him on it. Like in this part right here.
I love this coming up. Classic Purple.
Oh, yeah. It's got to be 100% Ritchie on that one. Into a proper Lord solo.
There we go.
Man, that was such a classic Purple instrumental interlude.
I was just gonna say
composed parts sounded like it could have been out of Rainbow too, but just phenomenal. You had like the harpsichord, you had an organ, you had a guitar solo, you had them matching each other.
Yeah, it's just like you have this kind of like a bit of an updated Purple song, and then it's almost like they just kind of slipped right back into like early 70s.
Yeah, like that could have been right in place on Burn, you know, like that same kind of almost quasi Bach inspired.
Yeah. But I mean, it's great. It's just, it's like going home, you know? Yep. It's like, there it is, nice and comfy.
Exactly. We kind of wish they'd brought it in a little earlier in the album, though. Here we are, six tracks in, there's a six track in, and we're finally getting the formula.
Yeah, but I don't know. I figured that you're a big fan of Purple. You're going to stick around and wait for it.
Quick fade out, and who knows how long that would have continued to go on in the studio.
Yeah, probably a quick fade out, because it was either it fell apart right away, or they're just like, look, this thing goes on for another 20 minutes, so let's just cut it here.
I could easily see that going on another 20 minutes.
Who even knows.
All right, A Gypsy's Kiss, what you gonna give that one, John?
There we go. Sorry, I'm not pausing on the rating. I'm just having some trouble with the spreadsheet here. I enjoyed that a lot more than I remembered. 4.5. I think it's a solid song. And I was gonna say, like, before that, the interlude, the solo section, I'm like, yeah, it's just really solid, kind of simple riff.
Yeah.
You know, simple Purple song, you know, just really good, catchy. And then like they go into all that Bach inspired classic Deep Purple stuff, and they do the kind of like the Highway Star thing, or is it was it Highway Star or Burn or something like that, I forget.
Well, I mean, it could have been either, really. It's similar, it's reminiscent of his Highway Star solo, it's reminiscent of Burn, it's,
yeah, just, you know, classic Ritchie, which he had done previously in the 70s, but it's just really none of it's out of place. Because, I mean, you know, these guys are all great songwriters and performers. So to kind of integrate that naturally in there, I mean, that's just the way they play. That's, yeah, it's not like, hey, let's try and shove that, you know, let's shoehorn that part in there. It's like a, you know, classical part, you know, classic John Lord solo, doesn't seem out of place at all, but it's kind of a nice surprise. It was in the middle, a nice little addition there. To an otherwise, I would say like average song or pretty good song, that like that elevates it. Because then you're just like, yeah, that's exciting. Because first of all, like all of Ritchie's solos, which I said on the last week's episode, sound like really improvised, but it's like he came back and was like on fire. Like,
yeah.
Like whoever the engineer was, like however he got his guitar tone, it's just like it came through on the recording, like that it was like raw. And then he was just like, my guess is that he probably did it in like a take or two, and he was just kind of like, just like whipping them right out. And, you know, that's the kind of intensity that I like to hear, you know, especially from a musician like Ritchie, where, you know, there are some albums it's been hit or miss, you know, due to, you know, the, you know, maybe the recording, or, you know, him not, you know, really caring that much, whatever it might be. But yeah, good stuff.
Yeah, I would say, if it wasn't for the instrumental part that really harkens back to the old Deep Purple, that this song would get like a 3.5 from me. but the instrumental really bumps it up to a four. Like, to me, it doesn't quite get to the place where maybe Burn might be, but it's really, they're like back in full form as Mark II. And I just think the interplay between the guitar and the keyboards and them working together and taking their solos is great. Really solid song. But the pre-solo part of the song to me is not bad. It's just, to me, doesn't quite get there until the instrumental part starts.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Excuse me. So our next track up is the track Wasted Sunsets. Classic Ritchie improvised, or not improvised, composed kind of solo.
You know, I hesitate to call this a ballad, but I don't know what it is. Like, it's better than a ballad. You know what I mean?
It's a super ballad.
No, it's like, it doesn't have that. It's like ballad-esque, but it doesn't have that vibe about it. It's like, it's like some kind of, it's a slow song, but it's not like one that you'd just be like, come on, honey, let's go out on the dance floor and slow dance to it. You know what I mean?
It's always sounded to me like it's part of a song. Like, it doesn't have that build that we've heard so many times in so many other bands and permutations where it doesn't start off as like just keyboards or just guitar and vocals and then build up to this point. It starts up at the built up point of one of those songs, or like what you'd expect in a power ballad. It builds up to this powerful point. This one starts off at it, which makes it really unusual to me. It just starts at this exact intensity level that it ends at.
I mean, I really like it.
Oh, it's phenomenal, yeah. Great performance by Gillan. Classic John Lord, really mellow organ in the background. Ritchie's solo is on fire. He can bring so much mood to a song like this. Almost got like a Soldier of Fortune kind of feel at the end there.
I was just gonna say that is, if this was like, you know what I mean, not to dispute the track order or anything like that, but that's what I guess this song makes me think of is like, it sounds like a Soldier of Fortune type of song where it's like a slower song or maybe a more emotional song that stays on that one level and has that kind of feeling of like, all right, this is like ending off the album. Like this would have been a great closer. Like if they hadn't done like a song after this, like this would have been a perfect song to end the album on, because it has that kind of like epic emotional feeling to it, you know, mostly provided by Ritchie's guitar parts, and I mean, you know, and the you know, if you listen to the rest of the song too, I mean, you hear some, you know, some great, like, you know, bass, some rhythm under there from Roger Glover. And I think that's one of those songs. Like, I mean, even though it doesn't end the album, it has that kind of like a like epic feeling to it. Like this is the,
it sounds like a finale.
This is the, yeah, exactly. That's a great way. I was going to say the ending of something. It sounds like the, like a finale, like you could make it a finale. Like if it's not for here, then you could make it for something. Like it could be like you think of it, like it's, you could play it like after you broke up with somebody, you know, it's like a breakup song.
It'd be a great song to,
you know, somebody,
it makes you want to break up with someone just so you can just go like drive off into the sunset and like sit there just all emotional listening to the song. Or just being a teenager in general and being all, you know, broody or whatever, and just listen in your room, listen to this. Well, like, nobody understands me.
Yeah, well, exactly. I know we're laughing about it, but it does. It sounds like a note, like, you know, you're sitting there and it's just like, it's very like kind of emotional. Or like if somebody that you cared about passed away or left you, or like, you know, it's like a song that makes me think of like loss or finality, you know, whether it's an album or something else, but that's kind of the feeling that it gives me. So it's like, even though it doesn't have those, like, you know, highs and lows of a classic ballad, like, you know, you were saying while we were listening to the song, it's got something.
But I think that's kind of what I like about it. Like, I think if you took this song back in 40 years ago, took this song to a song doctor or whatever, they would like, oh, we're going to punch it up. And there's so many like more cliche things you could throw into here. Like for instance, it just starts with the piano and Gillan singing, or just an acoustic guitar and Gillan singing over it. And then it like slowly builds up, the drums come in, the bass comes in, it builds up to this big crescendo, and then it does the whole thing. And then it goes back to just the piano with Ian's vocals. And I'm sure you could rearrange the song and make it sound really cool that way, but it's also, it would not be, there's plenty of songs that do that, that do it really, really well. And it would not make this song stand out in any way. You'd have to turn this into maybe like a 6-minute song, the whole build up, and it would be great. But I love the fact that it's not song doctored. It's just like, this is what they're feeling. They're just going to boom, kick right into it. Right with that little guitar, the composed guitar part in the beginning, kick right into the song, deliver all the lyrics, do a cool guitar solo, and then we're done and we're out. And I think there's something to be said. Right. For that too, it doesn't need to have all that formulaic stuff thrown in there. So,
oh, absolutely. I think that you know, this is like the full band or electric version of what's the other song we're just talking about?
I don't know.
How come it's like
Soldier of Fortune?
Soldier of Fortune, yeah, because it even has some of the same like melodies in it that Gillan was singing. When I think about it, it's like, if you think about this song for a minute, played with just an acoustic guitar and Gillan singing it, like you were saying, if a song doctor took it and he was like, so, or say they just did a different version of it, say they did the unplugged version of it, it's like another case of maybe subconsciously or maybe consciously Ritchie trying to do another idea over that he did once before. Or, you know, maybe it's just the fact that that's the way that, you know, he and, you know, some of the guys play, and they just come up with that because it's just so, you know, these patterns and these melodies and everything are just so ingrained in that. Maybe they make, you know, they write a song that's similar to another one, they don't even know it.
Yep.
But I mean, either way, I mean, it's like, it's fantastic. It's great.
All right. So how do you rank Wasted Sunsets?
4.5.
All right.
Wasted Sunsets. For all the reasons that I just said and will not repeat.
Yeah, we just kind of talked about it. I will also give this one a 4.5. I think it's a great one. It's just a great, I love songs that just capture a mood so well, and this is one of them.
Much
in the way that Soldier of Fortune does.
Yeah, I think I got very like cerebral with my interpretations there.
But you're a cerebral kind of guy. Don't let those shoulders, those pecs fool you that you can see John's tank top on. He's very cerebral. He's not a himbo.
I'm not a mimbo or a himbo. Yeah, I'm not just a not just a bunch of muscles and
he's just not all muscle, this guy. He's also got some brains.
Not all muscles. The muscle between my ears is also very perceptive.
Your best attribute.
All right, but anyway.
All right. So but Wasted Sunsets does not close out this album, because after that we got one more track, and that is the track Hungry Days.
D-A-Z-E.
I always thought it was a weird play on words. It's another one that's kind of like, it's weirdly like heavy, but also weirdly like kind of, it's a little more whimsical. And goes to a completely different place than you'd expect after the whimsical opening.
Right. Yeah, but if you took that that riff and you threw some distortion on it, you could make it really heavy.
So it sounds like kind of Gillan and Glover recounting their days before joining Deep Purple, or as they joined Deep Purple.
I always like that line.
Yeah, he gets ahead of himself. Ah, oh, that's another song. We'll get to that later.
We all came out to Montreux, but that's another song. Like that self-referential stuff. Oh, it's a couple of those screams. Some cool stuff going on here.
Glover showing off his production chops. Like, he keeps saying Hungry Days in this, and he's using it interchangeably between like being in a daze and daze, D-A-Y-S.
Huh.
he's saying these are the hungry days, but earlier he's saying in the hungry days, so.
Okay.
But it sounds like when he's opening up the song, he's talking about the hungry days, like before they joined Deep Purple, when him and Roger Glover were sharing a pair of pants. That they only had one pair of pants between the two of them, and you know. And he even says the stinking hippie, which is what they used to call Roger Glover. So like, it sounds like he's recounting this, going from episode 6 into Deep Purple and things falling apart in Deep Purple. And I'm not sure what the overarching theme is. I'm just kind of my interpretation of the lyrics. I love the Muppet voice at the end. I love that they kind of fake you out into thinking you're going to get a fade out, but they're like, nope. Just going to end it real tight. Bashing my head into this microphone. All right. Hungry Days. You want to take it away?
I'll give this one a 3.5.
All right.
I think it's good. After hearing it and then... maybe a little biased, you know, here in Wasted Sunsets, thinking that this probably shouldn't have been the last song. I think it does like end out the album on a mood, though, like the kind of just like really abrupt ending. It is an ending. It's like it's not a bad ending song for it. I think Wasted Sunsets could have been a cooler ending track, but overall, I think that this is a pretty decent song.
Mm-hmm.
I was listening to a lot of these with like, you know, kind of a fresh perspective now, because I haven't listened to the album in a little while, and there were a lot of songs that kind of caught me off guard, like, wow, all right, yeah, I like that a little more than I remembered. Just because I, you know, when we listen to these albums, they're not casual listens, we're like sitting and actually listening to them. But this one didn't strike me as much. I think this ended at the perfect spot, because if the album went on for another song or two, I think that it would have started running out of steam.
Yeah, totally.
So, and here I feel like it did like a little bit, but not quite. So I'd say this is a good song, not great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'll agree with you 100%. 3.5 for me as well. It almost seems like Hungry Days, Wasted Sunsets, if you just flip those two around, you would have had that little like little dip in the towards the end of the side, and then boom, ended really strong. But I think it's, to me, Hungry Days is probably the weakest track on the album, but it's a good track.
Mm.
It's a good rocker, the really great little it's bebops around, it keeps you interested. You got some great screams by Gillan, but yeah, just not, to me, probably not up to the level of the other tracks on the album.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right. So that wraps up the album, which means it is time for us to see where does Perfect Strangers stack up in the in our album reviews. Given that rating.
Well, it's
before we get to the other before we get to the official reviews, what does our review tell us?
So our review tells us that it actually does rank quite high combined for us. 8.5 rating. There's a 0% variance. We both rated it 4.25 each, so we're equally like this album.
Yeah, we rated a couple songs differently, but yeah, in the end, we ended up at the same.
Yeah, order. Yeah. So we pretty much like the album the same, and it's actually one of our highest rated albums.
Whew.
So we go California Jam, which, you know, we don't really count. White Snake, of course, David Coverdale, White Snake, Rainbow Rising, Jesus Christ Superstar, Perfect Strangers.
Wow, out of 57 albums that we've reviewed, this comes in basically fourth.
So you want to take out like California Jam and Jesus Christ Superstar. If you want to handicap it, just because California Jam was a video, Jesus Christ Superstar, like four side album, you know, that's kind of unfair. So you'd say Coverdale's White Snake, Rising, Perfect Strangers. And then actually trailing that is Long Live Rock and Roll. Stormbringer, Come Taste the Band, which I am really surprised that Stormbringer and Come Taste the Band are behind this one.
I'm totally, totally shocked, to be honest with you.
By a little bit of a margin. I think it comes from the fact that,
you know, like if Burn didn't have A200 on it, that, for example, that would have probably made it pop way up into the thing. I think the total collection of the songs on Perfect Strangers is really solid, and there might be a, you know, there's, I don't want to call A200 a dog, but it definitely drags down the overall average for Burn.
Yeah, but I mean, I think it's, like we just said, a solid album.
It's our highest ranked Deep Purple album combined. Like I ranked Stormbringer higher overall than this, but and Come Taste the Band just ever so slightly higher than this, me personally, but combined it's our highest ranked Deep Purple album.
All right. I ranked Stormbringer higher and Come Taste the Band a little bit higher. So if you're talking about personal preference too.
No, you ranked Stormbringer lower.
That's right. I'm looking at your ratings again. Okay. All right. Well, screw me then.
I guess it just goes to show you, like, a song that, like, an album that doesn't have, there's been some great albums that have a couple filler tracks on it. And it's also been, I don't know, a year and a half since we covered any other Deep Purple albums. So,
Long Live Rock and Roll was exactly the same ratings for me, too. And I mean, you know, you could take that with a grain of salt. You know, I mean, if we went back and did another show or did another pass over our ratings, like, hey, what would you rate this album now? It could be different.
Yep.
This is just what I rated it today. And that doesn't mean that tomorrow I'm going to hate Perfect Strangers, but, you know, it's definitely up there for a reason. I mean, it's pretty solid. I'm kind of surprised because even though, like I was going to say, it's good, like solid, like production, it's consistent in terms of like the songwriting, like the sound, the playing. It's not like all over the place. It's not like an album like a hodgepodge type album, almost like Fireball or something like that. You know, which had a lot of kind of different, you know, kind of a patchwork of styles on it or something. It sounds really like one album. Like Machine Head sounded like a collection of songs. In Rock sounded like a collection of songs. So does this.
Yep.
You know, well written, what have you. But I'm actually kind of surprised because of the lack of classic Purple elements. Like not a whole lot of featured John Lord, at least not in the way that we would probably most like it. I mean, you know, he added a lot of like texture to the songs. He, of course, had like two iconic intros, which is nothing to sneeze at. But, you know, not a lot of, you know, interplay between him and Ritchie, not a lot of extended solos or anything that, you know, featured him, which was always a little disappointing when I don't get a lot of that. But yeah, from him on an album. But
I mean, this is a very well regarded album in Purple fandom, and you know, we could sit here and play 40 years after Quarterback or whatever all we want. But I think the only criticism I'd really have of the album is it would have been nice to have some more John Lord
or a little more featured John Lord. But
yeah, a little more solos, a little more interplay between him and Ritchie.
But that being said, all around. Yeah, that being said, I mean, you know, great songs, great performances. I'm just saying, like, I'm kind of surprised that, you know, given what we like from this lineup so much that we, you know, I mean, we know what we wanted, but we didn't. Well, I mean, I guess you can't just be like, oh, they're not a lot of John Lord solos, like two. You know, it's like you're not gonna do that.
Wasted Sunsets gets a two because there's no John Lord solo.
But it's just like it's kind of. Yeah, well, I guess that just goes for the songwriting. I mean, it's like, I also feel that there were like a lot of good songs on the album too. Like you could tell that they were going for the songwriting. And I mean, by now, by this time too, I mean, Ritchie and Roger Glover had been doing those Rainbow albums, like, you know, chasing for the commercial aspect of the business, you know, chasing the hits. And, you know, they were good at it. You know, they were good at like producing and writing and trying to come up with that stuff that would be, you know, attention grabbing and, you know, get on the radio or be, you know, commercially successful or something that people would like. But I think that they kind of, you know, they achieved that, but still being themselves, doing their formula, being Mark II, being just a good band, not just being like, oh, let's put out hits, because it's like, you know, you're not going to hear like an 80s style hit on this album,
right?
By any means. But, you know, they know how to write a song that the fans like, and it was obviously successful. And yeah, great job.
Sure thing. All right, well, that, my friends, was Perfect Strangers. Before we move on, we're going to cover some of the reviews and things that happened after the album. But before we move on, we're going to take a little break to thank our core level patrons. Coming in at the episode $6.66 tier, we have Richard Fusey. At the $5.99 nice price tier, Fielding Fowler. At the $5 moneylender tier, Greg Sealby, John Convery, Arthur Smith, German Heindel, Adrian Hernandez, Kenny Wymore, Jesper Allman, Alexi the Perfect Stranger Slyperkov, James North, Mark Hodgetts, and newest patron, Kev Roberts. Thank you, Kev. And at the $3 Nobody's Perfect tier, Peter Gardeau, Ian DeRosier, Mark Roback, Anton Glaving, Will Porter, Andrew Meyer, Duncan Leask, and Stuart McCord. Woo! We're going to have to break up the core level. That's so many people.
Yeah, that's a lot of peeps.
And speaking of our core level patrons, Mr. Kenny Wymore sent this in the other day, which I thought was really, really interesting. So he sent this in. So he got this copy of Roger Glover Elements at the record store. And here's what he has to say. Hey guys, I thought this was funny, so I had to share it. I picked up a copy of Elements on the vinyl the other day. It's a white label promo copy. The funny thing is that someone wrote mostly mellow jazz on the cover. It looks like someone also scratched rock in between the words mellow and jazz. So it could have read mostly mellow rock and jazz if the rock part had been in ink too. The picture doesn't really show that though. I don't think I would use those adjectives to describe this album, but okay. Now, since this is a promo copy, it makes me wonder if the person who originally owned this received a lot of promo records and marked all of them this way by writing directly on the album cover. It seems like a barbaric way to catalog something, and one that would only be employed if you received so many albums that you no longer cared about them. Anyway, I thought this was funny. Adds a bit of mystery to the ownership chain of the album, if nothing else. Picture attached. So there it is. If you zoom in, you see the looks like ballpoint pen, mostly mellow jazz. I just imagine like somebody getting this in a collection and just like he listens to it, it's like, eh, mostly mellow jazz, and just tosses it like aside. Next. You can even see this big crease in the cover here. Like probably just threw it off to the side. Done with this album. Not interested. But yeah, it could have been like maybe it was something sent to a radio station. But it's funny that they wouldn't even use like a, I mean, I guess if it's old, they wouldn't have had post-its, but like a post-it or just some other way of doing it. But to actually just write it directly on the album cover is like kind of sacrilege. Anyway, thank you, Kenny, for sending that in. I got a real good kick out of that one. Mostly mellow jazz. It's not mostly mellow jazz. I think the that song, the air, the song about the air, what the heck's the name of it? Roger Glover, Elements. That's the song that kind of sounds mostly like jazz. The fourth rings with the wind. That song, I think, maybe is what maybe this person got to that song is like, this is just mellow jazz, because it's kind of that repeating that rhythm mostly, over and over again.
But mostly mellow jazz.
Mostly. Just makes it seem like right down on a Kenny G album, not on this. But makes me want to listen to Elements again. I haven't listened to it since we did that episode. It's such a good record.
Makes me want to listen to some Kenny G now.
You want to just listen to some mostly mellow jazz. Okay, so To wrap up this album, so after a few weeks of recording this album, Ritchie and Roger flew to Hamburg to mix the album. Ian Paice said in the Tommy Vance interview, he said they hoped they could inject a little more thought and class into rock and roll. So there's this great interview disc that I don't have back there, but it's back there somewhere. But it's basically called The Interview Album, and it's just interviews with all five of them about this record. Ian Gillan described what he thought was going on with pop in the mid-80s as a fashion show. Ian Paice says, "It's kind of annoying because all the exciting bands seem to be coming from America at the moment, and that's not the way God intended it." Like that. As I think we talked about last week, the CD and cassette original releases contained an extra track. The cassette release contained the track Not Responsible, and then the CD re-release in the 90s, I think late 90s, contained the bonus track Son of Alaric, which is the B-side to Perfect Strangers. Which is a solo Blackmore composition. It's a instrumental, a long instrumental. I think it's like 10 minutes or something. So we'll have to cover those another day. So the album was obviously a huge success. It reached number 5 in the UK charts, number 17 in the US. It was the second album to be certified platinum in the US after Machine Head. And the following tour was such a success that they had to add a bunch of additional dates because they just kept selling out because people wanted to go see Deep Purple again. Said in 1985, their tour was only outgrossed by Bruce Springsteen. No other band matched them as far as that goes. Roger Glover said of this album, "It's a great moment in time." This is weird. And I can't remember where I saw this quote, but Roger Glover says, "A great moment in time, but as an album, it doesn't quite hang together," which I find a very odd quote. I mean,
yeah, seems, it is.
I mean, it just seems like such, like you talked about many times, sounds like such a cohesive album. Like everything just sounds like it belongs kind of together. So,
yeah, that's an odd way to like promote your album.
I don't know that he said it in the promotion phase of the album. He said it at some point. It might have been more
recent. Okay. Yeah, okay, I was like, gonna say, like,
all right, Roger, get out there on the road and sell some albums. I don't know, it doesn't really quite work. I'm like, get him out of there, get somebody else. Put somebody in marketing in these interviews, Roger.
Yeah, right. He was probably maybe said it like 10 years ago or something. For all
yeah,
I
exactly,
know,
exactly.
That doesn't sound like something you'd say, like, you know, right on the heels of recording. It's like, well, it doesn't hang together, but I mean, you know, it's all right, I guess. So let's just
you see Bruce Payne in the background, just kind of get him off. You're killing me, Roger.
You see, like, the big, what is it, that big cane from, like, what is it,
from the Warner Brothers cartoons, yoink.
Or like that show, what was that show where like somebody be playing and then the cane would come out, like, what was that show where somebody would get up and they do an act and they'd be like, boo, and Roger Glover would be like, ah, as they like dragged him off with the cane.
Ian Paice says, "To me, it's a natural progression from the earlier records, but with a 10-year growth period in between. It was a revelation to capture the spirit of the Mark II Purple once again. Very refreshing." John Lord says, "A perfect album. It said everything about the band that needed to be said. We weren't trying to be super new in the 1980s band, and at the same time, we weren't just a nostalgia band." And there was a lot of talk about that too when they're talking about getting the band back together. I forget who the main talk. I think mostly Lord and Blackmore. I think all of them were just saying, like, we'll do this reunion, but we don't want it to just be a nostalgia act. Like, oh, we're going to get together and play the greatest hits of Machine Head or whatever. They wanted right. to create new music, and I'm glad that they did. Ritchie said, "We put Deep Purple back together to annoy the press, basically. Give them something to bitch about. That is really our number one priority, to upset the critics." So typical Ritchie response to whatever the question was. And then we get into the reviews. So shall I start it off with the review from Rolling Stone?
Ugh. I'm already annoyed. Go ahead.
And you should be. Perfect Strangers, review by Deborah Frost. 2 stars.
That frosty bitch. All right. Let's see what she has to say, Ms. Frost.
Ms. Frost, if that's your real name. The title track comes blasting out of nowhere, like I'm alive and well message from an old friend you'd given up for dead, with its steamy vocals and genuine if uncharacteristic touches of wit throbbing above Deep Purple's heavy signature sound. Perfect Stranger sets the tone for this venerable band's reunion album. Lead singer Ian Gillan, who's never been in finer and deeper throat, sinuously glides into lyrics that suggest these veterans have something to say about where they've been the last few years. Can you remember my name? I'm an echo of your past. And have lots more to offer in the future. For a moment, you almost wonder why Purple ever faded away in the first place. Until, that is, you hear the rest of the album. Oh, and here we go. We're off to the races. Now I can spend the rest of the review trashing the album. Accepting the title cut and the rambunctious but less effective knocking at your back door, the material consists of hastily knocked off jams that allow guitar demigod Ritchie Blackmore to whip out his finger exercises in public. The band spent about 6 to 8 weeks recording this comeback. The current lineup is actually neither the original nor the final Deep Purple, but the most successful of Smoke on the Water fame. It doesn't sound as if they spent much more time thinking about it either. Blackmore's Strat has such a great roar that if you're willing to just let it reverberate in your eardrums for a bit, and it's nice to hear John Lord's unsynthesized organ squalls, Ian Pace's meaty pounding, Gillan's howls and whispers, and Roger Glover's solid bass lines once again. Even though it's enough of the sound check already, where are the songs? Instead of Glover, an outside producer might have forced the band to tighten up its licks and arrangements. Then again, did Deep Purple ever have more than one or two really good concise numbers on an album? Maybe they're just making the kind of record they always did, the only one they know how to make. So why are they doing this? To cash in on the current heavy metal craze in which dozens of young upstarts are making fortunes playing Purple riffs? Following a recent Meet the Press shebang promoting the album and impending world tour, the band members, minus the temperamental Blackmore, who true to his An image didn't show. Instead, they don't need the dough. Perhaps the answer lies in Wasted Sunsets, a portrait of an aging rock stars who got gold and silver for blues, but nothing to do except to drink the nights away. It's nice that Perfect Strangers got Purples out of their respective mansions. Too bad they didn't venture farther from home. So there you go.
Well, it doesn't really sound like she's trashing it. Two stars gotta, obviously sounds like she's trashing it,
but it doesn't. She's a music critic, so she's got to get all these little digs and show off her, you know, kind of like, how witty I am sort of stuff.
Yeah, but it's not like, it doesn't sound like, you know how some of our, like some reviews that, you know, you've read before for other albums downright like, you know, no talent hacks, blah, blah, blah. This is kind of like, it's not really complimentary, but it doesn't sound like outright uncomplimentary or insulting either. It's just kind of like,
there's a few things like, you know, a few things like hastily knocked off jams. Well, like, I mean, that's kind of all, I don't want to say hastily, but they've always just been a band that jams on a riff and then kind of puts songs together. They're not like, Deep Purple's not the greatest song arrangers of all time. They've got a formula that I think works really well for them, that they do well together. Also kind of painting Blackmore the way that like people will paint a lot of shredders these days. But I don't get that with Blackmore. Like, oh, he's just like practicing his scales and trying to go as fast as he can. It's like, I mean, maybe it's just because we've been desensitized for an additional 40 years of hearing what real shredders do. But when you listen to this, everything Ritchie Blackmore is playing is really soulful and from the heart and has a ton of passion in it.
Yeah.
Even if some of it's like, whoa, where did he go with that? Like he's going almost off the rails on some of the stuff. It's not like he's like, you know, Michelangelo Baddio and just like just playing with Tantu's necks and like just trying to do it a sweep arpeggio as fast as he can. There's still a ton of feeling and everything in what he's doing. So.
Oh yeah.
But anyway, that link will be in the show notes if you care to read it. Another one, it's more of an article from the LA Times, just kind of about, the other thing about the article is, it is always fun kind of reading stuff from this time about how like these guys are so impossibly old. I can't believe that, you know, these guys, they were all younger than you and I are right now when they were doing this. And, you know, they were all in their late 30s. Maybe like, John Lord might have been in his early 40s.
Yeah, late 30s, early 40s, like maybe like Yeah, I mean, but I mean, that would carry on through like even the later 80s, where everybody was like, the Rolling Stones are so old in like 1989, the Steel Wheelchair Tour, and they were like,
30 years later, they're still touring. It's like, it's, you know, I mean, that's just kind of funny that they would consider anyone in their late 30s or early 40s just like, why are they even doing this crazy? It's insane to think of these geriatrics on stage doing this. Like, it's,
they were like 28, like 10 years earlier. Like, it was only 10 years ago that they were around, and they're still around now. This was like, this yeah. album was what, like almost 40 years ago.
Yep. Yeah.
Now they're old. Absolutely. They're still good, but it's like, now they are old.
Yeah. Gillan would have been 39. Well, he would have turned 39 in 1984. So when he recorded this, he might've been 38. So, I mean, that sounds 38 still. Sounds pretty good to me these days. But it's so funny how that's kind of changed so much. And I guess it was less common back then, and now there's so many more. We're just used to, I mean, I'll think of, you could rattle off 24 bands right now that are in their 60s and 70s, you know, from everyone from Rolling Stones to Kiss to Deep Purple to you name it. They're just Aerosmith. All these guys are still out there doing it. So, well, if there was shows, they would be doing it, but they're still around and none of them have called it quits. So,
right.
And, you know, these are the same bands that 30 or 40 years ago people were saying were too old. So there you go. LA Times article, it's more of an article just kind of about the leading up to it. It kind of goes through the split up of the band. John Lord has some quotes about why they broke up, you know, a lot of petty arguments, and then they kind of just go into a little bit more of the article ends with a lot of good quotes from Glover, but Glover says, it says Glover is realistic. The harmony, he speculated, is only temporary. He says, we're basically the same people we were 12 years ago. So there'll be fights. But this time we have enough experience to know what not to do. We won't let petty differences get big enough to cause a split again. But we all know the friction will happen. There's always friction in this band, and there always will be. So there you go. Then we've got the review in the Deep Purple Appreciation Society magazine, which is great. And actually, we've got some really great stuff. Jeff Bryce sent us some really, really cool stuff. About Perfect Strangers, including Darker Than Blue, which is the old Deep Purple Appreciation Society magazine. And here's a copy of his copy. And opening it up is issue number 29, July 1984. Kind of goes through the stuff about the reunion, some cool pictures there. All these different articles and things about the Deep Purple reunion, which is really cool. Really, really cool stuff. So I wish I had some of these old copies. They sell on eBay really expensive though. So if anyone's listening and they're like, oh man, I'm so tired of having my complete collection of Deep Purple Society, Deep Purple Appreciation Society magazine lying around, they're really clogging things up, I got to get rid of them. Just send me a message. I'll put them to good use. But really cool stuff. But on the online version, I'll have a link in the show notes. There's a review, and it says the album hit the record stores here on October 29th, though most London stores held out for the official release date of November 2nd. The cover appalls me. Looks like something a 13-year-old would carve into the school desk in a moment of boredom. The music, you know damn well what went down at those rehearsals in the studio must have been electric, yet the energy doesn't always communicate itself to the listener, which is a shame. The temptation in reviewing it is to get carried away by the fact that they are back together and rave about the goodies while playing down the more mediocre stuff. That would be wrong. Knocking at Your Back Door effortlessly crosses the gap between commercial and hard rock in a way Rainbow tried so long to achieve. Lovely chugging strings in the intro, Pacey lays into it, the Hammond swirling about, and the very typical Blackmore riff. Polished performances all around and disgustingly catchy. Nobody's Home is a hard rocker, Steal from Lay Down, Stay Down, amongst others. Mean Streak doesn't consist of much at all. Pounding bass, hi-hat, and what sounds like a good organ work buried in really muddy sound. I find it hard to say a lot about the title track. It is everything Purple ever were to me. If I had to justify the reunion to anyone, this cut would suffice. Ian's vocals charged with emotion, all set over a gorgeous piece of work from the band. It belongs up there with the best of everything they've ever done before. Wasted Sunsets is nicely predictable. It could have made a blinder. That's probably like, and I've heard that's like a British expression that I don't really exactly know what it means. Could have made a blinder. I don't know. One of our great British listeners will have to translate that for us. I'd have liked a quiet start, taking it up gradually to increase the power. That's funny, which is exactly kind of what we said about it. Hungry Days is a bit of a letdown, being the best bit being the middle part. Third Stone from the Sun Revisited. The Burn album is probably the closest point of reference in terms of how I feel about the album overall. That too was recorded quickly and showed some marked change of style. This time we've been prepared somewhat with Rainbow and the shadow of the band that is fairly strong. More variety in the manner of Gillan's output over the past few years wouldn't go amiss. So I think that's a pretty good review. Kind of states a lot of what we stated. It's funny, I didn't read this before we recorded, and I'm like, wow, saying exactly what we said about Wasted Sunsets. Although he's saying he would have liked it a little bit more to have that more of that build to it. And I'm saying that I think that would have been good, but I think it's interesting that they do it this way. It's interesting and different.
Yeah.
So pretty good review there. So yeah, we got a lot of great stuff from Jeff Bryce. He sent, I'll put some of the stuff in the show notes. I sent over this great press release they sent for the band. So it's kind of a biography of the band. We've seen this before. I forgot which, I think it was the Burn album with the lineup change kind of going through. So it's like the legendary lineup has returned with a masterful new album. You know, it's obviously all marketing. Goes through a lot of stuff. It's talking about Book of Taliesin, Concerto for Group and Orchestra, going through the whole history of the band. Going through Machine Head, Who Do We Think We Are, and then kind of talking about them disbanding after that. And since it's a van, their legion of fans remain loyal to the band and continue following all the exploits of the individual members, and then just talks about the getting back together and what the new album is going to be like. So it's kind of a cool cool little artifact there. And Jeff Bryce has everything imaginable when it comes to this sort of stuff. And then our old friend Jorg also sent us a few little tidbits here. Here is a review from Kerrang by our good friend, Jeff 3 stars Barton. Although he's not really getting into stars in this one. So it says Deep Purple, Perfect Strangers. So like, what did you expect? A bold step into the 80s, a la Yes and their titanically technological 90125 album, or a tedious exercise in crass money-making by people going through the motions who should be old enough to know better, or more of the same? Well, place your bets on the last category, folks, because with Perfect Strangers, the old DPs take up right where Machine Head, and let's forget about Who Do We Think We Are, shall we? Left off. Neither a disappointment nor a revelation. The first LP from the reformed Deep Purple is chock full of good, solid, acutely English heavy rock. So he goes through all of that. He ends with Perfect Strangers is good, solid comeback album, but is that enough? I'm inclined to think that for the time being it is. Although by the same token, if I was still on the other music paper, I think I'd fight shy of awarding this disc a full 5-star rating for the moment though. Let's just say it's great to have the guys back and predict that the next one will be the killer. I think you missed the mark on that one, Jeff Barton, but we'll get to that on our House of Blue Light review. Don't want to give too much away. But yeah, I mean, House of Blue Light would have been 3 years later, and they spent a lot of time touring, and I could see why I would think that, but I don't know. We'll get to that when we get to whatchamacallit, House of Blue Light. So here we go. Another one in Melody Maker. This one's by Barry McElhenney. Strange, but not perfect. starts off, "We've all heard a lot in the recent months about the growing state of despair in this green and pleasant land, a mood that can be detected in a number of different places. The current spate of divisive, blah, 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 blah. Yes, they're back in all their original glory. Masters Gillan, Blackmore, Glover, Lord, and Paice, the very same lineup as featured in all those early albums, detail of which are supplied here in the crucial family tree that will get to help you with such weighty matters. This, along with the inner sleeve notes of the boys, is by far the most entertaining part of the whole thing, with hours of fun for the family as you will try to work out who went where in the 15th split, caused, of course, by serious musical differences." So it goes on and on and on. He talks about the album and concludes with, "But I hear you ask with increasing frustration, is there nothing at all worthwhile about this long-awaited return of Deep Purple? Well, no, to be perfectly honest, there's not. Because the whole idea of a band like Deep Purple, who had far more their allotted 15 minutes of infamy in the first place, coming back to haunt us young things with their bizarre lyrics and horrible music, is best a very sad development, and at worst, a somewhat offensive reflection on the assumed average intelligence of today's record buying public." So there you go. Somebody who,
this guy. Wow, that was pretty scathing.
Yeah.
That was insulting. That's what I expected from Rolling Stone, from the Frosty Bitch.
Yeah, it says the title track itself does initially go some way towards rescuing the entire album from mega turkey status, boasting a rather neat hook line or whatever you want to call it. But then again, it is fatally infected with the mumbo jumbo imagery that crops up all over the place with depressing monotony. So yeah. So, but he kind of admits at the end, like, basically this guy hates Deep Purple. So I guess what are you going to expect?
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, somebody forced him to write about it, then, you know.
Yep. Oh, I'll write about it. All right.
It's fine. I'll review it, even though I think they're trash.
Yep.
Idiot.
Yep.
Stupid idiot. I don't like him.
Then got two really short ones. One from Sounds. This is a review of the single. It says, "Up and coming newcomers in record at wrong speed scandal. 3 days wasted searching for a record player with a 78 RPM speed selection. That funny looking Gillan and his boys have had fun, but they're not as heavy as the league." Don't even know what the hell they're talking about.
What? Ugh. I don't.
Yeah, sometimes the record reviewers are just like, you know, I think that's kind of the main issue with like a lot of the record reviews. It's like, you know, just cut the bullshit. And just talk about the, you know, they have to use all this flowery dialogue and go off on these little asides and have these little parentheticals and talk, look how witty I am. And it's just, you know, just freaking talk about the music. But I guess kind of like that. Is it that Frank Zappa quote, like writing about music is like dancing about architecture? You know, I think it's kind of that. It is hard to write. It's hard to talk about music and you can't really do it in any sort of objective way, but
yeah.
But it would be nice if they were trying less to be so cheeky and more to just kind of say, here's some, you know, kind of being a little bit more middle of the road and straight about what you like or don't like about it.
Right.
Then we got this one from UK Review, "Perfect Strangers. Can you remember my name?" asks Mr. Gillan. "Well, no. Can you? Is it John Lord who plays keyboards here? Whoever it is sounds exactly the same as it did 15 years ago. Some things never change, and this is one of them." So, very
okay.
Another kind of quick, look how witty I am, whatever, 100 word, not even 100 words.
You know, like we were talking about the other week, like, look at me make my pithy comments.
Yeah, exactly. I'm so clever. Hey guys, look what I just said. Look at the scathing thing I just said about Deep Purple. It's unbelievable.
Excuse me while I put in my monocle. Idiots.
Yeah. A lot of that going around. But I think what they're talking about, the family tree thing, is the classic I guess it's the Pete Frame thing, which is, I guess this must have come with some sort of, I guess this came with the UK single, which is that kind of Deep Purple family tree when it was much smaller. But you've got you know, starting at the top, you've got, you know, the Artwoods and the savages and the outlaws all kind of like coming down this tree into Roundabout, which forms into Deep Purple, and then the split with where episode 6 is and where Elf and Rainbow split off and Black Sabbath. So White Snake splitting off back later. So this is a 1984 version of that, which has only gotten more intense. So, and you can buy like framed copies of this right now, and they're super expensive. I always wanted kind of the most recent one, because or any of them, they look really cool.
You know, that's one thing that looking at this kind of makes me think of is I've seen stuff like this. Like, we always talk about the Deep Purple family tree. Mm-hmm. And this is a obvious literal object of it, but I don't think that I've really, and I'm sure other bands have done it too, but I don't think that I've seen too many other bands do this kind of thing, because I remember somewhere seeing this, and that's where I got the whole notion of the Deep Purple family tree. Mm-hmm. Which I think is one of the cool things about this band, because it's like, even that version, this older version of it, it's just, it's pretty impressive how it splits off and goes in all these different directions. And, you know, I think it's really neat.
I like this as a historical artifact, because you see, yeah, it only goes up to, unfortunately, the resolution, I don't think. Well, no, it goes up to Whitesnake Mark IV. Which includes Cozy, and then you've got in Mick Moody, and then it goes up to Black Sabbath splitting off to Dio, and only the first mark of Dio, because this is 1984. So you've got Vinnie Appice, you've got Jimmy Bain, you've got Vivian Campbell. So you've got this kind of snapshot in history. Like, imagine Dio is probably only around for less than a year when they made this, and how many more incarnations of Dio were there after this, or Whitesnake, for God's sake, or Black Sabbath, all of them. So, you know, even Black Sabbath was just, Black Sabbath had Ian Gillan, and there was no, they hadn't even gotten to Glenn Hughes yet when this was made. They didn't even know where Black Sabbath was going when this poster was made. So it's really cool. And now I know you can download like a PDF of this, and it's huge. And I would love to have like nice big framed copy of that, because it's really cool.
It's neat.
But then I also feel like maybe I should just wait a little longer. Don't want to have the second to last version of it. But yeah, Jeff Bryce sent that over. He sent over some great stuff. And I'm feeling we can do our Perfect Strangers Part 3 some point in the future and cover the unreleased songs and all of this stuff, some of the other stuff that Jeff Bryce sent, and there's so much other stuff to cover from this, never mind the tour. And then somebody on deeppurple.net, they kind of compiled a list of some of the disparaging things that had been said about this album and the band getting back together. The Record Mirror called them leaden granddads. 38 years old, you're a granddad. Like, come on, man.
My God.
Granddad. I'm far older than that, and I'm not close to being a granddad. Record Mirror says, the one I said earlier, some things never change, and this is one of them. Melody Maker called it bland and sluggish. The Bury Times said dated plodding heavy metal. Music Week said old gits.
What?
Yeah, so those are just some of them, but I'll put a link to that in the show notes as well. Just kind of funny, like all these people taking all these pot shots. It's just, it's idiots. Ridiculous.
So stupid.
All right, and there you go. There's reviews, and before we close it out, of course, we want to take some time to thank our foundation level patrons, our $1 made up name tier that consists, of course, of L's Murders, Spacey Noodles, the Nasty Leaky Mausoleum, Michael Vader, Stephen Somerville, the Concerto 1999 fanatic, Raff Calf, and of course, Spike the Rock Cat. Thank you to all of you for your continued support of the show. Raf Kaff got his, did you hear Raf Kaff's yard of questions on the last Pod of Thunder?
I did not.
Yeah, on the last episode, yet. whatever that was. They picked his yard of questions, which was great.
Nice.
Yeah. So really cool to hear a patron represented on another podcast. Very cool. And some of our patrons are patrons also on the Uriah Heep podcast, which is another, always good to hear those names shouted out as well.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So there you go, guys. Perfect Strangers in the can. Two-parter. Third part coming. Who knows when. We cover all the rest of that stuff.
In a year.
Yeah. Episode 300. Yeah. But it's been a blast. I've really digging into this. I'm surprised by our ratings. But it's been really fun revisiting this one and kind of, like I said, this is one of the albums, one of the first albums I really got into with Deep Purple. And then it didn't really carry on much beyond that. Like in recent years, I haven't listened to it as much, and I'm really glad to dive into it again and see what I really liked about it 30 mm-hmm. years ago, because I still do. So thank you everybody for listening, and we'll talk to you next week.
Good night.
Thank you for listening to the Deep Purple Podcast. If you like what you hear and would like more episodes in the future, please donate on Patreon to support the show. You can also leave us a review in Apple Podcasts to help new people discover the show. You can follow us on YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook for show updates. See deeppurplepodcast.com for more details. Thank you for listening.